Stay standing for just a minute. We do ask that you squeeze in as much as you can so the ushers can continue to seat people. Don't pay attention to the lines and the chairs. Treat them as a pew, and we're glad you're here.
Well, you all may be seated. I shouldn't let you because I've been the song leader here many years under Dean LaVelle, and so I count this as a real privilege to be asked to do this. And really, I normally would make you stand, but I will not at this time. But you do have to promise to sing your full heart out, because I know that this is a, really, this is a time of celebration, and this is what Dean would want. And so we're going to sing the song that I've always done after we pass the plate. So we're not passing the plate, just letting you know that. But we are going to sing, and I want you to pay attention to the words of the song. And it's the doxology, and I think they're going to be up here on the board, right? And I hope I can see my page. Even though I have glasses, they don't work. So I don't know. You know, my tendency is to have you stand, but I promise I will not. Let's sing this, and really sing this from your heart. The words are so good to this song. In this song, praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. And we're going to do it two times, okay? So, praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Praise God.
Okay, we're going to do the next song. It's Precious Lord, Take My Hand. And you know the Lord has Dean's hand today, and before, really, today even. And even though this is sad for many of us humans here, he's in good hands. And he's been able to just step in. And how wonderful that is. So we're going to do both verses here. You don't have a book. I do, but I forget I can look back there. So anyway, we're going to sing Precious Lord. Okay.
Minister H. Dean LaVelle, 84, of Arkansas City, Kansas, passed away Wednesday, November 13, 2019, at his residence. Dean was born June 21, 1935, to Victor A. and Bessie B. Brandon LaVelle in Colorado Springs, Colorado. He was reared and educated in Colorado Springs and graduated from Colorado Springs High School in 1953. After high school, Dean attended San Jose Bible College, then transferred and graduated from Midwest Christian College in Oklahoma City, Oklahoma in 1960. On December 31, 1954, Dean married the love of his life, Phyllis Kraxberger, in Arba, Colorado. The couple made their home in San Jose, California, and then Oklahoma City, Oklahoma, while finishing his degree at Midwest Christian College. During college, he ministered at Union Home Church of Christ in Glencoe, Oklahoma. After graduation, he ministered at Cashin Christian Church in Cashin, Oklahoma from 1960 to 1962. First Christian Church in Shidler, Oklahoma from 1962 to 1965. First Christian Church in Coweta, Oklahoma from 1965 to 1970. Then the family moved to Arkansas City in 1970. Dean was the minister for Bible Christian Church for 44 years until his retirement in 2014. Dean loved his family deeply and enjoyed many special times camping and fishing with his grandchildren and family. Survivors include his children Gary LaVelle and wife Robbie of Bridge Creek, Oklahoma, Deanne Splechter and husband John of Arkansas City, Kansas, Grant LaVelle and wife Anissa of Carl Junction, Missouri, grandchildren Aubrey Baker, Alan Carter and wife Heather, Evan LaVelle, Carrie Wolf, Andrew Splechter and wife Catherine, Lily Long and husband Jason, Ariel Webb and husband Kevin, Ashley Weiss and husband Justin, Emily, Ian, and Eric LaVelle, great-grandchildren Madeline, Emma, Paisley, Garrison Baker, Karis and Evelyn Carter, Landon and Caden Frick, Jasmine, Kira, and Emmett Wolf, Lucy Webb, Easton Splechter, and numerous nieces, nephews, brothers and sister-in-laws, and friends. He was preceded in death by his loving wife, Phyllis, his parents, his sister, Leela Snively, and granddaughter, Allison Larie Frick.
Well, before I pray, I was asked to just share a few words, and the first thing I want to say is I just want to thank everyone who made the trip to be here to celebrate my grandfather's life today. To those of you who traveled a distance to get here, you know, on behalf of our family, we want to say thank you for making the time to get here. To those of you that are from Ark City, he wanted you, he really wanted you to know how much he loved Ark City and the people of Ark City. He loved this town, he really did. And his desire more than anything was that we would all come together under the name of Jesus. And so today that's what we're doing. We're coming together under the name of Jesus. And it's because we can celebrate this man so easily because his life was marked by that name, Jesus. And a few years back, I came across this scripture that I think really captured his life succinctly. It's Psalm 90:12. It says, "Teach us to realize the brevity of life so that we may grow in wisdom." See, Grandpa had this incredible gift of capturing every moment of God's saving grace in his life and retelling it to himself and others consistently. Every hard season, every near-death experience, every small moment from the day he was born to the day he died was an exercise for him of recognizing God's grace and love in it all. And there were several stories throughout his life that he often reflected on that many of us have heard before. And those are a few of the stories that I want to share today. From the day he was born, he realized the brevity, the shortness of life. 84 years ago, he was not expected to live. He was born a blue baby with a cord wrapped around his neck. And they removed it and sat there waiting to see if he would breathe on his own. And in that moment, as a little baby, God wove wisdom into that barely beating heart as he learned to trust God to give him his very next breath. Before I tell this next story, I have to emphasize that he was growing in wisdom, which means that he was lacking in wisdom. As a young boy, Grandpa was trying to light a cigarette. Mistake number one. But he decided that he would try to light this cigarette by reaching deep down into this ash pit to catch the cigarette on fire. So that's mistake number two. And he lost his balance and fell partially in himself, actually, and quickly got himself out. And he said he realized in that moment that if he would have fallen in completely, nobody would have found him, and he would have been burned alive. And as a young boy, I don't want us to miss this. He recognized God's saving grace in his life, and in that moment, God wove wisdom into a rebellious heart. And he began to realize that this one life is a precious opportunity to impact the world. As an 18-year-old high schooler, he was terrified to speak in front of anyone, getting nauseous with nerves in his early days of communicating. In fact, his senior speech in high school was supposed to be 15 minutes long, and he finished it in 9 minutes. And, you know, he decided in that moment that he would never stand and give a talk before anyone ever again. No, we all know that didn't happen. And at 18 years old, he recognized God's sustaining grace in his life. In that moment, God wove wisdom into a fearful heart. He learned that life was too short to fear anything but God. And not only that, but the areas in his life where he felt like were his greatest shortcomings and weaknesses, those would be the areas where God's power would be most clearly seen throughout his life. You know, as a young man, Grandpa got cold feet before marrying Grandma. And he took the ring back, which is a big deal, and he called off the engagement and the wedding. And that was mistake number three. But he quickly realized that that was a terrible decision and they got married. His wedding band still has their original date on it. But in that moment, God wove wisdom into a doubting heart. He recognized God's relentless grace for him in the story of him and Grandma getting together. And he called it God's looking out for him when he almost made one of the worst mistakes of his life. See, over and over, the more Grandpa reflected on his life passing by, the more he grew in wisdom and became confident that Jesus was the best message worth communicating. And as his granddaughter, I had the joy of hearing his sermons right here every weekend of my life growing up in Ark City. But his best sermon, without a doubt, was the way he lived his life, especially the last 5 years of it. Grandpa said, actually, just a few years back, he told several of us in the family that the last 5 years were some of the best years of his life. And I just want to share with you what his last 5 years looked like. He finished formally preaching, something he loved to do, to care for his dying wife. Then the love of his life of over 60 years of marriage died, and he grieved and wept. And although every single person in this room loved him so well through that season, he could not deny that he felt so lonely without his helpmate. A year later, he lost a granddaughter in a sudden car accident. The grief felt like it came with an even greater force. More death made its way into the story as he lost in-laws and many friends. Many of our family had various hard things we were or are going through that he prayed for and grieved over. His body began to wear down, grow tired. He lost a lot of weight. He lost a lot of muscle. He became weaker and weaker. And these were his last 5 years. So why would he say that these were some of the best 5 years of his life? Because I know all of us, we have so many cherished and beautiful memories of him over the decades and decades before these 5 years. So why did he say that? That's what I've been thinking about. You know, I don't think it's because he loved life less 5 years ago, but because he loved God more in these last 5 years. You know, he took every trial, every heartache to the feet of the Father. He left no stone unturned in his grief, and honestly, sometimes that was really, really hard for us to see. Sometimes you'd be having a normal conversation with him, and he would just begin to weep with grief. And while that would be hard and even awkward at times, this is what I love most about this man. Grandpa was willing to come undone before God. And in that, God mended his broken heart back together stronger than ever before. His hardest years became the years where God's grace and wisdom became the most tangible to him. And in these years where the swiftness of life became even more real, God wove wisdom into a hurting heart. He recognized God's refining grace that carried him through fire. He loved God and felt loved by God more than he ever had before. See, most people just go throughout their life without ever thinking about what God may want to teach them throughout each day. But for Grandpa, every single moment was an opportunity to understand the extravagant grace of God. And he thanked God daily for another chance to walk, breathe, and live for him. And because my grandfather, our friend, took those opportunities to realize the brevity, the shortness of life, you and I all stand in the wisdom that he left us. We do. And he would want nothing more than for us to experience God's life and love and wisdom the way that he did. A week before he passed away, he posed this question. What does a truly living man say to those who are still awaiting death to take them? I summarize them down to 3 points that start with an R, because that is what you do at a preacher's funeral. The first R, rejoice. Rejoice in the good things God does for you. Celebrate the love that he has for you and be specific about what that is. Grandpa said the words grace and peace in the Bible are never reversed. Grace always comes first. We can't have peace without grace. You know, we can't even begin to fathom grace if we don't name it. So rejoice. Be specific about what God has done in your life. The second R is reflect. Reflect on the shortness of life that you may gain wisdom of heart. Don't rush through the day. Take time to notice the things that God is trying to teach you, because we are all better for him doing that. Grandpa said, God is interested in the little things as well as the big things. He wants us to see his creative power, and the more you do, the more purpose you will carry out into your days. The third R, the final R, is respond. Respond to God. He is working in your life, even when you don't always see it. Trust and acknowledge that he is with you. I want to close with two scriptures that Grandpa loved and wanted said today. The first one reflected his deep trust in God's provision throughout his life. We've seen it come to pass. Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And he is. The second verse reflected his great hope in the day of Jesus' return. It's 1 Corinthians 15:22. Just as everyone dies because we all belong to Adam, everyone who belongs to Christ will be given new life. But there's an order to this resurrection. Christ was raised as the first of the harvest. Then all who belong to Christ will be raised when he comes back. And I love that. All who belong to Christ will be raised again. Grandpa knew who he belonged to. And today we grieve. We do. But we don't grieve as those with no hope. Today, he is truly living. Let's pray. So Jesus, we just dedicate this time to you. We thank you for a man that gave his life to you, that we are all better for it. We thank you that he was so faithful in the small things that has impacted us so deeply. Father, I pray that we would, like him, realize the shortness of life, that we may gain wisdom of heart. We thank you for this life, Lord. We celebrate you today. It's in Jesus' name. Amen.
I've ever seen or done. How could I dare to claim as mine the victories God has won? Where would I be had God not brought me gently to this place? I'm here to say I'm nothing but an old sinner saved by grace.
I'm just a sinner saved by grace. When I stood condemned to death, he took my
today, and that was certainly his intention. He worked very hard, even up to the very end, to make that happen. And in fact, he wrote everything down that he wanted to say. But the truth is, when he finished, he was just a little bit too weak to speak. And I look at it this way. He lived 84 years preaching the word in speech and deed. He's done his part. So it's my great honor and privilege to share on his behalf this morning or this afternoon. And I trust God's grace and wisdom will allow us to honor both God and Grandpa, which is what he wished. I've chosen to define Grandpa's life as a man of great loves. He loved his family. He loved his wife. He loved truth and God's word. He loved the church. And he loved his Heavenly Father, whom he increasingly referred to as Abba, which means daddy. And when he loved someone or something greatly, he devoted his whole life and attention to that. I can't speak of my grandpa's great love without beginning with grandma. Proverbs 18:22 says, "The man who finds a wife finds a treasure and receives favor from the Lord." I don't think Grandpa treasured anything in this life more than he did my grandma. He considered himself to have discovered the greatest treasure he could ever find. He wrote this. He said, "I wished I had taken more time with her and hugged her before it all came to this. I loved her so much, and I always will. She's my first and my last love. No one can replace her." Did you know that after she died in 2016, he never again slept under the covers in his bed? He laid on top of the bedspread, up the bed, and pulled a blanket over himself. Did you know that while everyone thought he looked nicer with a goatee, he religiously shaved it off on their anniversary or on her birthday or any special moment that noted an event in their lives. Because while she was alive, she didn't like him with facial hair. He frequently spoke of how when she died, he no longer had a home. He just had a house now. It wasn't a home without her. He used to write little love notes from Zorro. That's what he called himself, and he would leave them scattered around the house. And she, in turn, provided encouragement, stability, and strength for so many years for him. "Dear Dean," she wrote, "how blessed I am to have you as my husband, and how blessed my children are for you to be their father. I forgot to buy you a Father's Day card. But I haven't forgotten how God blessed me nearly 50 years ago. May God continue to bless you each time you stand up and preach. Love, Phyllis." They truly loved each other, and their marriage is such a beautiful example of Jesus and the church. Ephesians 5 reminds us that the relationship between husband and wife is the closest earthly comparison to how Jesus feels about his church. And the highest compliment that I can say about my grandpa is this: if the world could see how much my grandpa loved my grandma, and they knew that Jesus loves the church like that and even more, I believe everyone would want to be a Christian. My grandpa loved his wife. And all of that flowed out of a love for Jesus. And I feel like that love for Jesus demonstrated itself in a faithfulness to three things. Grandpa lived and breathed the Word of God. Standing out in the foyer on a pedestal is one of his Bibles. I want you to look at that as you leave today. It's completely worn out. There are places in the Bible where you can't hardly see the words of the Bible because he's written so much in there and he's marked so many tally marks. He read his Bible at least 67 times from front to back. Since 1990, he read the Bible 53 times. He read it 10 times since he retired. In addition to that, he read through the Psalms and Proverbs every month for many, many years. You know, a lot of people don't consider the work that goes into being a great preacher. It takes a lot of unseen hours of rewarding, but sometimes really tedious study. I told him before he died, I said, I'm thankful for all the tally marks in the margins of your Bible, for all the hundreds of thousands of pages you read, so that you could deliver the best sermons you could in service of our Savior. Despite being silent, solemn work, that was the loudest and clearest sermon he ever preached. I was amazed reading through his journals these past few years how much God's word sustained him. And I thought it was ironic that as his appetite for earthly food began to diminish, his craving for daily bread increased. Jesus says, "Man does not live by bread alone, but by the word that comes from the mouth of God." We got to see a living example of that verse. Grandpa loved the word of God, and he loved imparting its truth. And he also loved to pray. Grandpa considered prayer one of the most significant pillars of his ministry. He prayed when he woke up. He prayed through the day. He prayed before bed. I feel like what he would have considered the most significant aspects of his ministry was intercessory prayer. And that was a thing he continued on for a long time. I think it was generally on Tuesday nights, but for those of you that never saw, he would print off a sheet every week with all the prayer requests that the congregation had or the community had or that he heard about, and they would pray for that at his home. And I want to point out some people that were a part of that, because I know they shared a special relationship. It was usually him and Grandma and Linda Mullins and Julie Kratt and Arlene Johnson. And if you're here today and Grandpa ever knew of a need in your life, you were on that list at some point, and those people prayed for you. Grandpa was a mighty man of prayer, and I'm thankful for those who labored alongside him in that. Grandpa loved the Lord, and that was reflected in faithfulness to do the hard work of ministry. Gary spoke of the early years of ministry, in particular, the amount of work that the whole family would put in. Grandpa was a meticulous person. We found that out in his requests for food in these last days. But he expected the church building to reflect that. The lawn should be trimmed and mowed. The glass shouldn't have fingerprints on it. The hymnal should be arranged in a certain way. They talked about how on Saturday night, a lot of times they spent it folding bulletins for the next morning, and how there was a lot of work that went into making Sunday happen on Saturday. They didn't get to do a lot of things on Saturday because they were always doing the work that was necessary. Gary talked about how before they would get to eat Sunday dinner or Sunday lunch, it was always, we go and we serve the shut-ins first, and then we eat. So it was mid-afternoon many times before they got to eat a Sunday dinner. He talked about how Grandpa would take communion out to the oil field workers in all the little towns in Oklahoma with the different oil rigs. Mom mentioned how growing up she always wished she could watch The Wonderful World of Disney on Sunday night. But what would happen every week was they would catch the first 5 or 10 minutes of it, and then it was time to be off to Sunday night service. For the majority of his ministry, Grandpa would preach 2 sermons per Sunday. And looking through his notes on things, the only time in his life that he wasn't up at least by 6, and most of the time way earlier than that, was probably the last couple months. He was devoted, he understood the task at hand, and he did whatever it took. 1 Thessalonians 2:9 says, "Surely you remember, brothers and sisters, our toil and our hardship. We worked night and day, not in order to not be a burden to anyone while we preached the gospel to you." Grandpa embodied that verse. He worked hard for the gospel. And because he worked hard, God gave him a few great loves outside of ministry. See, Grandpa was born, as was mentioned earlier, in Colorado Springs. And though he came to really, truly, genuinely love Kansas, there was always a little spark of excitement when it was vacation time. And many of our fondest memories from our family were spent there. Grandpa loved the mountains, and his sister Leela, and all his nieces and nephews. And you can only imagine the fun that we had when he was untethered from the rigors of ministry for 2 weeks every summer. Personally speaking, one of the great loves that Grandpa and I shared was fishing. I got to spend countless hours with him at the lake or at the river or in the mountains. It was a common bond, something we both loved to do. And who can forget Grandpa describing the size of the fish he caught as being this big and then slowly dropping this hand to reveal the truth, okay? Sometimes ministry is overwhelming. And life is hard, and you just need a break from work. And an afternoon at the lake was usually what the doctor ordered. In fact, we both loved to fish so much that when we went fishing, we talked about fishing. He would tell me stories of fishing with his brother-in-law Sherman up in the mountains, or we would reminisce about some place that we had visited before and a time that we had spent fishing together. We would talk about some place that we saw maybe on the way out to where we were fishing that looked like a good spot to stop next time. We loved to fish so much that while we were fishing, we talked about fishing and made plans to do it again. Those times were precious. We were 2 friends sitting on a bank. I'll miss my friend. But Grandpa had other loves outside of fishing. He loved to make people laugh, and he loved to laugh himself. If you've ever had the joy of standing in front of him in line at McDonald's, you'll know that one of his favorite gags was to pull out this little guy, his $1 million bill. And he'll plop that thing down, and he'll say, "I got it." I remember we would be driving around Colorado and we would see, "Oh, that cabin is really pretty. You know, it'd be nice to live there, you know." And he'd say, "Oh, I'll just use my $1 million bill to pay for that." The truth is, this thing is just about as worn out as his Bible. He used that a lot. It brings back memories of me and our family sitting around the dinner table, and he would tell his jokes, and Grandma would have heard them for the 40 billionth time, and so she would just roll his eyes at that point. Grandpa loved to make people laugh. He was always good for a one-liner. Did you know that studies have shown cows produce more milk when farmers talk to them? It's a case of one in one ear and out the udder. Have you ever tried blindfolded archery? You don't know what you're missing. I saw a man standing on one leg at an ATM. I asked him, what is he doing? And he said he was checking his balance. I've been reading a horror story in Braille. As I've read it, the sense has come over me that something bad is going to happen. I can feel it. Or did you hear the one about the skunk that went to church and it sat in its own pew? Oh. Maybe you didn't know, but they're not going to make yardsticks any longer. You can ask your spouse about that if you don't get that one. Grandpa always had a way to put a smile on people's faces. Maybe even despite himself sometimes. One of my favorite stories about him, he was young, it was way before I was born, and he told me about it. He was a young minister, and he was spending a week at camp. And he was one of the leaders of the camp, and there was two brothers there that just caused trouble the entire week. And he got so sick of their games and their trouble that the last day came, and they were trying to pack up and get ready to go home. And this kid just wouldn't stop. So he took the older brother, and he grabbed his arms, and he tied his arms with a rope around a tree. So he was stuck like this. And he said, I'm leaving you here while we do this, the things we have to do, and then I'll come let you go. Well, he got busy, and he forgot about it. And the boy was still sitting in there, and the parents started arriving. And sure enough, the boy's father rolled up, got out of the car, and he saw his son tied to a tree, and he looked at him and he said, that's a good place for you, and he kept walking. Grandpa was a fun guy. I'm going to miss his laughter and his jokes. In fact, last night at the funeral home, I had to poke him just to make sure he wasn't playing some joke and he was going to pop out and say boo, because I could totally see him doing that. He loved to laugh, and his joy will be missed. You know, Grandpa also loved his family, and because he loved his family, he left us an inheritance. As we've been going through items, we've realized that we've inherited a lot. We've inherited enough fake flowers and greenery to decorate you and your neighborhood's homes for any season of the year. We have inherited enough plastic ice cream tubs and Tupperware to hold all the potato salad from all the funeral dinners in all of South Central Kansas for his entire ministry. We've discovered that we've inherited enough leftover vitamins to keep a common person alive for approximately 372 years. We have inherited enough typewriters to publish a daily newspaper. We've inherited a legion of red Solo cups, because heaven forbid anyone use a real glass and Grandpa actually have to turn on the dishwasher. Grandpa got into this phase a few years ago where he would print off his Facebook feed. He didn't have a smartphone yet, and so he would come out to church and he would print off everything that came out every day on his Facebook feed. So, if you want an encyclopedia of popular internet memes from 2012 to 2015, we can supply that. I apologize to the church for the small fortune in ink that was wasted on that. And I want to thank the forests of the earth for their great sacrifice. We've discovered journals and lists and notes on absolutely everything under the sun. We've been given a lifetime of books and sermons and illustrations and pictures. He left us with traditions. We're a real high-class bunch of people. So instead of waving goodbye at each other when we leave, we do this little number. At Thanksgiving time, you better have snuck a bite of the turkey in before Grandpa started praying. Because once he got going, you were going to be there a while. We pass around ugly family heirlooms in a never-ending white elephant Christmas exchange, and it wouldn't be Christmas in the LaVelle house without getting new socks and underwear. And we tease each other because we love each other. But he didn't just leave us with those things. And with those traditions, he left us with a spiritual heritage. He has passed on a love for the Lord to our entire family. Two nights ago, I got to have a conversation with my daughter, Karis, about that. And she was having a hard time because her Papa Dean was gone. And I told her it's okay to be sad that Papa Dean is gone. But I said, because we all believe in Jesus, we also have great hope, because we know a day will come when we see him again, and when that day comes, we're not going to say goodbye anymore. And we got to talk about how blessed we are as a family because we have the same hope in Jesus. I don't say that to elevate my family over anybody else's. It was a testament to his concern for us spiritually that happened, and I know that's unusual, and I'm so thankful that even down to us grandkids and now great-grandkids, passing on a love of the Lord. I think about my own life. He preached my ordination, performed my wedding. He spoke truth to me in so many ways. He's been a spiritual father in my life. He shared so much wisdom with me through the years. The truth is, I know even beyond myself, beyond my family, He's left a spiritual inheritance, and I want to ask you a few questions. And when I ask these questions, I want you to keep your hand raised, please, okay, until I've asked them all. How many of you were baptized by Dean or led to the Lord by him? If you'd raise your hand. How many of you had your marriage performed by Dean? Raise your hand. How many of you would consider Dean to be a foundational influence on your walk? Raise your hand. Now look around. We have a bond in our family that's caused by blood that we don't get to choose. But all of us have a bond in spirit that is eternal. Blood is lost and lives end, but spirits last forever when they are entrusted to the hands of Jesus Christ. So I want you to look around at the spiritual heritage that exists in this room because of my grandpa. Put your hands down. The last thing that I want to share this morning is Grandpa's love of preaching. And I think if I didn't preach the gospel this morning, he might roll around in his casket. And that might make for a good story, but I think we better do it. Grandpa loved to preach. He loved to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. The best estimate that we could come up with was somewhere around 4,000 sermons preached. He wanted everyone to know the power of the working of the cross of Jesus Christ. Romans 1 declares, "I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God to bring salvation to everyone who believes. First the Jew, then the Gentile." And Grandpa knew this truth so well. He was never more thrilled in ministry than he was when somebody accepted the Lord. Gary shared a story from when they first moved to Ark City. He said one of the first things that was impressed on him, one of the first baptisms that he can really remember, was that of Dale Conard. He said, Grandpa, Dale came forward that Sunday and he was baptized. And Grandpa was so excited when he left church that they got into the car and they turned the corner and he struck another vehicle because he was not paying any attention. Grandpa felt that way about everyone who came to the Lord. He was so thrilled. And he said this, what does a truly living man say to those who are still awaiting death to take them? He said, the statistics on death are still 100%. Everyone is going to experience what I have just gone through. And I want you to be ready. And he wanted everybody in here today to be ready. And he wanted everybody listening who's not here today to be ready. Listen to his own words on his own life. He spoke this, and this was within the last couple of years. Okay, this is not when he was 19. He said, my father, rather than to tell me to change, he creates the change. I've been trying to clean up my imperfections and my sins so that my father will accept me. When I need to see that he accepts me through his grace and he begins to clean me up. He is my heart surgeon who opens me up, removes my heart, and gives me his. And he not only wants to get me to heaven, but wants to get heaven into me. And I don't know where you're at today, but there's nothing more than I would love to do than have a conversation about Jesus if you need to have that. I don't want you to leave here without doing that today. Find me after the service. I'll talk to you. But I think there's a far greater number of people who do love Jesus here. And I want to conclude with reflecting on how Grandpa loved all of you, and you in turn reciprocated that love. Collectively, you are all brothers and sisters in the Lord, and he loved each one of you dearly. He said this. He said, I've been in 5 different communities over the years. There have been trials, but God has blessed me with respect and kindness by the residents, and I praise God for that. Jesus said in Matthew 5:45, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. And you all have done that in so many ways towards me. Everywhere we went, we were blessed. And he really meant that. He didn't just mean that from his own body of believers, but Grandpa really loved a lot of other churches and other people in the community. And he considered them to be fellow workers in the Lord. And he had a great relationship with so many other ministers and so many other churches. And I think that's an important legacy to leave. I want to thank you all for loving my grandpa. Thank you. Thank you for loving him in big ways. I'm always reminded of every Christmas time when the church would come up with some creative way to bless grandma and grandpa. I think more recently of the car. I mean, a lot of you guys probably gave towards that. That was not something that had any eternal value, but it demonstrated love in such a powerful way. He was absolutely blown away. He could not believe that everybody loved him enough to give that to him. Thank you for all the small ways. Thank you for all your prayers, your visits, your cards, your love expressed over these last few months. Every time Grandpa had a visitor, it brightened his day. And it brought him so much joy. Thank you. Every conversation that was ended in prayer for him, he cherished that so much. He really did. I thank you for giving in secret ways. Grant told me a story about a number of years ago. The church, they gave Grandma and Grandpa a trip to Israel to go to the Holy Land and to visit it and to see. And Grandpa told Grant, you know, he said, I really want to take you too. But they didn't pay for that part of it. And so he said, we're going to pray about that. Okay, and they did. They went around the kitchen table and they prayed that God would supply that need. And guess what happened? Anonymous gifts started just coming in for no real reason. They didn't ever tell anybody that that was a need or a want. And they just started coming and they kept coming and they kept coming until it was the day when the money was due for the trip and they were still $50 short. So Grandpa gathered them again, and he said, we got to pray again. So they did pray, and they waited till that afternoon, and the mail came through the slot in the wall, and somebody stuck in the mail and stuck in some frozen fish and stuck in $50, the exact amount they needed. So he took it down and he gave it to the people organizing the trip. I don't know how many stories of things like that there are in my grandpa's life. We will probably never know them. But thank you for the times that you gave secretly, that you prayed for my grandpa. Thank you for following this command to love my grandpa as yourselves. You know, the truth of all of this is that I really consider my grandpa an ordinary man. I don't think there was anything spectacular about him on his own. He knew he was a servant of the true and living God, and he never sought to be anything more than that. Thankful for his humility in preaching. There's a lot of people that don't preach because they love Jesus more than anything else. There's a lot of people that preach because they love themselves a little bit more than Jesus. He counted it an honor to be an ordinary man because he knew how extraordinary God was. And his extraordinary God called him to live out this verse. Even when I'm old and gray, O God, do not forsake me until I declare thy strength to this generation, thy power to all who are to come. Psalm 71:18. Luke 9:62, Jesus mentioned, no one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God. And it's with gladness that I share today that Grandpa never took his hand off the plow. He completed the task of his life first. Love marked his life because Jesus marked his life. I want you to know that Grandpa may have had a part of guiding you to Christ, but it was always about Jesus. It was about his power working through my grandpa. That's why he wanted that song, Just a Sinner Saved by Grace, because anything special about my grandpa's life was because of Jesus. Everything that drew you to him, the joy, the laughter, the compassion, the truth, the genuine love for others, was Jesus shining through him. I really believe that my grandpa was an ordinary man who lived an extraordinary life and made an extraordinary impact because he served an extraordinary God. We can still know and serve and trust and depend on that same God today. The preacher that preached the message may be gone, but the message is still alive. Grandpa fought the good fight. He finished the race. He's kept the faith. We have had the privilege of not only witnessing that, but being invited to carry on in that legacy. Let's pray. Holy God, we celebrate the life of Grandpa. We celebrate what he meant to so many of us. We're so thankful for him, thankful for his life. So precious to so many of us, Lord Jesus. But you were so precious to him. Lord, I pray that we would each take the challenge seriously, Lord. That your Holy Spirit, the same Holy Spirit that clothed his life in so much grace and so much honor and so much respect, Lord, that Holy Spirit is still alive and at work today. We want to be people who are about carrying on that legacy, Lord. You haven't come back for the rest of us yet. You haven't called us home yet. We still have work here to do. Lord, we look back at his life, but we always also look forward at what he's instilled through your Holy Spirit in each one of us, Lord. And we pray that we would be worthy workmen to that task. Lord Jesus, we love you. And we thank you for giving us a friend, a father, a grandfather, a pastor, a preacher, like Grandpa. We thank you for his life. We praise you for him. And it's your name we pray, Jesus. Amen.
One. the sea. One pair of hands made the sun and the moon. Every bird, every flower, every tree. One pair of hands owned the valleys, the ocean, the rivers, and the sand. Those hands are so strong, so when life goes wrong, put your faith into one pair of hands. One pair of hands heal the sick. One pair of hands raise the dead. One pair of hands
we would like to invite anybody who has a special memory or a thought about Grandpa to come. There's a couple rules about this that I want to just share. So just for the sake of time, I think everybody kind of knew this was going to be a pretty long funeral. There's going to be a little timer on the back wall. If you come up to speak, we'll start that timer. And if it gets to zero, a bomb will go off. No, we'll just start playing the Jeopardy song. No, we're not going to do either of those things. We're not going to cut you off, but we realize that it's hard to gauge how long we talk sometimes. It's just a guideline, just a little reminder, so that we have a chance for everybody to speak who wants to do that. So at this time, there's microphones on either side of the stage. Okay, or we can. Richard will be willing to just raise your hand if you don't want to come forward, and we'll bring the mic to you. Okay, so.
For a number of years, Dean had an early ministry at McDonald's. We have others that have a ministry at McDonald's during the day, but Dean's was always early in the morning. And I got to be part of that about 15 years ago for several different times. I was able to do that. But eventually, and I imagine it's probably around the time he retired, he quit doing that. And a few years ago, with his budget constraints, he told us in Sunday school he needed to cut back on his expenses. Instead of eating two eggs a day for breakfast, he would just cut back to one. I don't know if he was already buying large or extra large eggs at that time or not, but he did. He was buying extra large eggs. Now, somebody's going to have to help me on the quantity here. But he shared with us in Sunday school that even though he determined he needed to cut back, God had his six. God had his back. And at last count that I recall from Dean, he had had 18 double yolk eggs. Do we remember a number greater than that?
I think it ended up being between 30 and 40.
Yes, praise the Lord, praise the Lord.
Well, Jack and I come to Bible Christian Church right after we got married in 67. And Dean wasn't here yet. We had another minister here. And there was one other young couple in this church. And so when we moved, they left. So I don't know if it was Jack or what, but anyway, they moved down to Texas, and so here we was. So this young couple, you know, didn't know nothing really, not nothing. We'd gone to church most of our lives, but not always. We neither one come from Christian homes and everything, but the deal is that I took over, was the one that was designated to lead the singing. So I led the singing for many years. And it was real fun, and we learned a lot, and we grew, and Jack went and helped Dean and Phyllis move here from Coweta. He was one of the ones that come help him move. But I remember Gary, and he was in our first youth group. We were his youth group leaders. Now, I don't know if he learned anything or not, but we had a lot of fun. For sure. And one time that he'd went and Jack had taken the boys and took them frog hunting. And that they had a good time doing that. And they got home wee early hours in the morning from that frog hunt. But anyway, what I want to say is I remember Dean, and I've told the kids this. I remember when we were young and we were moving just across the street. We'd bought our first house. So Dean calls up and he says, "I's his, you's moving." He says, "I's do hauling." And I've been as naive as I was. I said, "Oh no, we thank you, but we don't need any help moving. And he says, ice works cheap. I did not know that that was Dean LaVelle telling me that. I really thought it was a guy that heard we were moving, and that's just one of the little things that he'd done. But I won't go on for that because my time's running out and I could go on forever. But I just want to say to you kids, what a blessing your dad was to us when he was here, and your mom. And I grew as a Christian because of the Lord, but because of Dean LaVelle and Phyllis. And I thank God that they were in my life because they were friends, and they was my preacher, but they were friends. And somebody else will probably tell the rest of the story, so to speak. But I know it's zero, but I gotta say one thing. I resemble that remark about the news feed on Facebook or whatever, printing out. I've done that.
I have to agree with Judy on most of what she said. Virginia and I came shortly after they did. So I think Dean and Phyllis had only been here maybe a couple of years when we joined the church. But I want to say, what an amazing family. You kids, being able to get up here and preach your grandpa's funeral, it just kills me. That's really a blessing. I wanted to tell one quick story, just a funny story about Dean. And like Judy said, most of the time he got you. I mean, I told Gary this the other night. You pay attention to what Dean is saying. I mean, everybody always paid attention. But you kind of got to remember, wait a minute, this is Dean. So that's okay, that's always in the back of your mind. We had a Sunday school party one evening, and it was a costume party. We was going to dress up. So Dean and Phyllis dressed up like Mexican banditos. I mean, they put on the dark face and they put on the sombreros and they had all the... And I had on my cowboy boots and my Western stuff and I had my six gun on. And I got there and I thought, I'm not going to wear the six gun on. So I probably just looked normal when I went in. I don't think Virginia dressed up. And as it worked out, nobody else dressed up. Dean and Phyllis was the only ones dressed up at this costume party, and they were really dressed up. Now, and we told him, no, we didn't mean to do this, but I know if you'd asked him a day before he passed away, he would have not believed that we didn't do that on purpose. I mean, because we never could convince him that, no, we didn't do that on purpose. But I just want to say, just like Judy did, Dean has been a really, really important part of our lives. And you family, you have too. I just praise God for a godly family and all the influence that Dean has had on our lives and the influence that you have had. So God bless you all.
I want to quickly give a word of testimony because I don't want to be left out. It was about 20 years ago that, by the way, my name's Dale Harms, my wife's Loretta. 20 years ago, we decided to move from Idaho to Kansas. We came here because Mark and Diane, our children, had moved here, and so we wanted to enjoy them, and we wanted to see their grandchildren grow up. So we moved to Ark City, and before we came here, we'd just been studying in our Sunday school in Idaho a book by Blackaby, Henry Blackaby, called Experiencing God. And that meant a lot to us. And so when we got here, one of the things that we learned in that course is that if you're looking for a new church, you got to see where God is at work. So we thought, okay, we'll find out. Mark and Diane are going to Bible Christian Church, so maybe we should go see what that's all about. And as we came to Ark City, guess what showed up? A bunch of men from Bible Christian Church came over there and helped us move. So Sunday we went to church, and then we got to know Pastor or Minister Dean LaVelle, his wife Phyllis, and then as time went on, we got to know them and the rest of the family, at least a lot of them. It was really a joy to us, and we found God at work here. Believe it or not, we're still here 20 years later. Dean became a good friend of mine. We did things together. We worked in the church together. We prayed together. He prayed for me and my family. I prayed for him and his family. And we worked in the church and enjoyed that very much right here at Bible Christian Church. I like the name BCC. That meant a lot to me, Bible Christian Church. And the theme here was then and ever has been Bible. Heavy on the Bible, Bible Christian Church. Oh, one thing I didn't mention is that we also fished together. And that became a good joy to us. And I hope my time... Oh. I've got a fish story. Is that okay? Well, okay. We had a canoe, a 16-foot canoe, and Dean seemed to be interested and wanted to go fishing. And he wanted to know if possibly he could go along in this canoe that I had. We wanted to fish at Cali State Lake, and so, yeah, sure, why not? And he said, by the way, he says, I have a grandson I'd like to take along. So I said, okay, we can take the tag along. That's Alan. And so I said, you know, we've got a strong canoe. It's a home, old town canoe. It's strong, and three or four people can ride in there without any problem. So shorten the story up a little. We went out to Cali Lake. We met out there. We'd had the tag along with us. And so we were getting ready to launch out into the lake. And so we had a brief meeting there on telling how to use the canoe, how to get in without any problem and that kind of stuff. So the three of us made it into there. And we headed across the lake. And no problem. Things seemed to be going along really good. And then our tag along, he said, I'd like to fish over on the other side. Why don't you just take me over there and I'll get off. I want to do some fly fishing over there, and then you guys can fish. So that's what we did. We went across, let Alan off there to fish, and we proceeded to get out into the water where it was deeper, and we wanted to do some crappie fishing. And now from what happened beyond this is debatable what happened. There's various stories about this, but I know I can tell from the laughter that some of you have heard a little bit of this story before, but I've got the opportunity now to tell the story. So we got out into the water, got ready to do our crappie fishing, everything seemed to be along, and then all of a sudden something happened. The canoe capsized, upside down, and then all of a sudden, those people, Dean and I and Alan, we had decided that it was probably best to put life jackets on, You know, if you're going to ride in a canoe, you need to have a life jacket. And I remember Dean saying, I'd kind of like to keep mine on. You know, it was a nice day. Sometimes you want to get rid of the life jacket. But he said, I think I'd like to keep it on. Well, when this happened, all of a sudden there was two guys out there in the lake bobbing up and down. And fear kind of got to me because Dean said, while we were floating around there, he said, I forgot to tell you, Dale, I don't know how to swim. True story. And so fear kind of got to me because I thought, uh-oh, here them have the minister of the church, and I'm out here. And one of the theories was that the reason it was upside down like that is because Dale said that he wanted to make sure that Dean had been immersed since he was a great believer in baptism. Immersion. I said, well, no, don't blame me for that. Trust, one time he got baptized, that's all right. So what are you going to do? So long story short, I tried the best I could. I said, Dean, get a hold of the canoe. Hang on. It's just turned upside down. Just hang on. And so we made our way back over there to Alan, and Alan helped us get things squared away. That was a scary moment for me, as you might imagine. And I was so glad for the praise of the Lord many times for those life jackets, because that would have made life a whole lot different. You know, I had a good time visiting with Dean recently through his tough times. We cried together. We prayed together. Talked about the good old times. He says, I really miss Phyllis. And I knew he did. He told me that many times. He says, I miss Phyllis. Now I want to tell you a little bit more about the rest of the story. Did you know that he was the publisher? I have with me a cover here of the book that he said he hadn't. I checked with him just recently. He said he hadn't finished it yet. Here's the name of the book. This is by Dale Harms and Dean LaVelle. Beneath the Surface. Get this new and exciting book. And here's a picture of it. And then later on, there was another one. He says, you read volume one, Beneath the Surface. Join now in the exciting adventure of these two men as they bring you volume two with this new book. The name of this book is Building a New Canoe Canal. In parentheses, it says 6 inches deep. And here's a picture of him in the canoe and me along the side. You know, we've had a lot of fun talking about this. He was a true friend. Dean was a true friend. His life was exemplary. I don't know of any time, and I served with him on the board when things were sometimes tough, but I never saw anger in that man. God's greater. Heaven's better. But we'll miss him. I'll miss a true friend. But, you know, it's with joy that I can attend this service and be a part of this and just let you know how much this, as Alan described, this normal man that was very extraordinary And I praise God for that.
I was one of them in the youth group going frog digging, if you remember that. We had a lot of fun together at that time, too. I always remember, though, if Judy's driving, always go right, because you get locked when you go left. You remember that? Dean took us down to Mid-America, or Midwest Christian College, in a little Rambler Classic station there. Gary and I in the back, along with Jody and another lady in the back, facing backward, because it had a back seat in it, and we're facing out the back. My sister's in the middle, and some other ones right there. It's so crowded back there, I had to hit my hip up on the window right there. My sister turned around, she goes, "They're kissing back there." What does Dean do? He pulls over that little Rambler Classic station wagon, yanks me out of there, puts my sister back there, and put me in the middle. I said, "I didn't kiss her." He said, "Yeah, you did. I saw you in the rearview mirror." I said, "I didn't either." So anyways, that right there kind of got me at my heart in a way, because he thought of us that much as his son, sisters, brother, whatever. Another time, I remember we put on a Christmas play at the church. First time my dad ever came to church. We was playing, they put my sister and me as brother and sister on the stage. It was a family type deal. And all of a sudden I thought to myself, I said, if I'm gonna be a brother and sister, I'm gonna act like a brother and a sister. I'm not gonna do no play acting. Sure enough, I did. I go, "Oh yeah, and by the way," dead silence in the church, and then all of a sudden the laughter broke out when I said, "By the way." My dad sat back there and goes, "Oh no." It went over real good, and Dean came to me after. He said, "That was the best part of the whole program. You act like you was your sister and brother on that stage." Okay? But when that touched my heart a lot, whenever he had commented on what I did right there. He touched my life a lot as a youth, dysfunctional family. But I remember in passing right there all the good times we had together fellowshipping, mowing the grass up at the church, the old church down there, playing volleyball and stuff like that around the back. All the little dinners we had and everything were always together and praying for us. But I appreciate your dad. You knew that.
I didn't get to know your dad as well as I wanted to. There's a verse in the Bible that says there, the strong man comes and he's going to beat you up. Lloyd Colston paraphrased. But if another man's there with you, you can persevere. But if three men are together, the strong man's not going to beat you up. Your dad was one of my cohorts. The back of the book says that the man that endures to the end is saved. And your dad exhibited, and I told him this on a visit or two, how much I appreciated him spreading petals of grace around while he was getting treatments. And he did that. His nurse would come and would be crying that she's missing church, and he would encourage her even through that. Your dad's a neat guy. I'm happy that he's in heaven, and you have a goal of getting there with me.
Real quick, I was handed this earlier. This is from Arlene Johnson. I've been asked to read this. And she says, before Phyllis died, I had the privilege of praying with Dean and Phyllis for over 20 years. I learned how to pray and have faith by their example, not just mere words. I think Dean exemplified Jesus the most in his ability to look at the best in others and freely offer forgiveness. I am a changed life because I walked with Jesus through the life of Dean LaVelle. That's from Arlene Johnson.
I'll do mine from back here because I have to turn myself on and off. Alan asked for a show of hands earlier. I'm going to put myself out on a limb here. That $1 million bill, anybody fooled by it? I was. I've been the treasurer of the church for a long time now. When we were raising money to build a fellowship center out there, guess what showed up in the offering? Paid in full. I fell hook, line, and sinker until, like Steve said, you always have to remember, but wait, that came from Dean. So you always got to question that. Alan also talked earlier about, praying for the money for Grant to be able to go on the trip. And he expected it to be there. I mean, he knew it was going to happen. He really, I feel he knew it. And when I heard him telling that story, I jumped right then. I said, I know that's going to end. It's going to be there. And it's going to be the exact amount. Those of you that helped a few years back with the car for Dean, that touched him. I remember the time I sat in that office. I told my wife, I said, I got to go tell Dean. He's going to buy this car. He's going to find a way to buy the car. We've got the money for him already. You all have given. Ford, I said, I've got to go talk to him. So I ran around that morning. I found him at the donut shop. I said, I need to talk to you a little bit. Are you going to be here? He said, I need to run back home. Can I meet you at the office in 15 minutes? Sure. I came out here, and I told him, I said, I don't know how to tell you this. We have a check for you so you can go buy the car. He couldn't believe it. He could not believe it. You truly touched his life. You really did in that one simple little thing. I experienced it. I just want to share it with you because it really touched him.
So, first off, I just want to say thank you. For coming here today. My dad and my mom would be so honored that you would come to celebrate his life today. And so I'm very grateful for that. But I want to echo what Kurt was just saying. I had a lot of privileges growing up as the youngest child. I think in many ways, my brother and my sister had a lot harder life than I did. I came along and I was just a little kid when they left and were gone. And so I was kind of, the spoiled child of the LaVelles. And so I was very benefited in ways, and a lot of that was due to this church. In the Church of Jesus Christ. And I'll never forget, there was a time when we were headed out to Colorado, we're on our way back. I can't remember, my memory isn't what it should be. But it really echoed my dad's belief that God was the provider. And, you know, we talk about, you know, people stepping up, and I don't mean to diminish any of that, but everything is God's. He owns it all. And he knew that. And, you know, there was time and time again when there was a need, and it wasn't just our need as a family, it was a need in the church, and God, my dad knew that God would provide, and he did. He would step forward, and there was a time when we were coming back from Colorado, I believe it was at my grandmother's funeral, and our car broke down in Syracuse, Kansas. Now, how many people have been to Syracuse, Kansas? Lot in Syracuse, Kansas going on. Well, yeah, I'm telling you, back in, I think, the early to mid 80s, 87 or 88, there was not an auto parts store in Syracuse, Kansas. And Mom and Dad had a very unique vehicle at the time. It was an Oldsmobile diesel. You couldn't find parts for it. It was... We were worried. I was worried because it had broken down before, and I knew how much trouble it was, but didn't faze my dad, didn't faze my mom. Here we are on the side of the road. We get our hands together, and we start praying. And me and being the foolish teenager, I'm like, oh, man, you know, people are going to see me out here. And I'm not joking, but... Dad and Mom were bold, and they knew, and we'd barely said amen, and a lady pulled up alongside of us. Hey, you broke down? Yes, yeah, we're broke down. Well, I'll tell you what, I'm going to go get my husband and see if he can help you, okay? He didn't even get back, somebody else stopped and asked. Come find out, they were all from the local church. God's church. And long story short, the Church of Jesus Christ took our car, towed it into the local school bus barn. Somebody went to a neighboring town, picked up the starter to repair our car and get us back on the road. All because they had faith. And they knew that we serve a mighty God. And too often, we doubt and we're unwilling to ask. And I've seen it time and time again. Yet I still doubt. So I want to encourage you today to be bold in your faith. Don't doubt your God. He is powerful. And thank you for being here today. We love you.
My name is Tim Baker. I had the privilege to know Dean for 4 years. If it wasn't for Dean baptizing my wife, I wouldn't have met a godly woman who keeps me straight in line. We were doing some painting, and off the top of my head, my wife put down a Bible verse from Psalms on the painting. Off the top of her head, if it wasn't for Dean teaching, this woman knows nothing. And when I went to Bible study, when Dean talked, it got quiet. He taught me something. He never stopped teaching. And I want to thank this family for having such a great, great father.
You know, where can you start? And my time here was really very short compared to Deanna Grant's. But the things that I treasure most is that I got to see my dad start out each location that he was at from the very beginning. And there was always something special about that location. Union Home was a small country church just north of Stillwater. And out in the middle of nowhere, red dirt roads, mud, ruts so deep you couldn't hardly get anywhere. And the families took them in. And the Wilson family, and we would go up there on the weekends, and he was a dairy farmer, and they would let me play in the grain bin, and you would get that smell of the cattle. And still to this day, when I smell cattle, I think of Union Home. But they were very good to my parents. And I think of Scheidler, or Cashin. And the people there were very good to my parents, very loving, still receive letters through the years from those people. And then moving on to Scheidler. And Scheidler was an interesting place for me, growing up early on from kindergarten through third grade. And that's about the time that I believe President Kennedy was shot. And so memories of that come back, but also going to church in the morning was always fun because Scheidler had a bell and a big rope, and you always got to ring that bell before church, and that was so much fun to let the community know that we were fixing to have church. It was a very neat and clean church, still is to this day. Very pretty little church. Purple windows, always had a nice, serene feel when you went into it. And got to encounter many revival preachers coming in, missionaries, things of that nature. And then we moved to Coweta, which was always a very precious church to me. And, even after we left and had moved here, the church at Coweta had a profound blessing to me. They had heard, and I don't know how they heard, because I'd never put this out, that I wanted to go to college, because I didn't. When I was done with high school, I was done with school. I was ready to work. But somehow, the Sunday school class there at Coweta heard that I wanted to go to college, and they decided to pay for my way. So the people there in that congregation have provided, really, the job that I have today and provided for me. And because of the impact that my father had upon that congregation, there's people here today from Coweta. And so, and then when we moved to Bible Christian, it was a small church. I believe there were 20 or 21 at the time, and relatively an older congregation, and very loyal. I think Ginger and Deanne and I were really the youth group, and as far as high school is concerned, I was Jack's only student. I was his prized pupil. And so it was fun to see the congregation grow, and it was fun to see. There was a time during the early 70s that I could see and sense Dad changing, and that he was growing in his spiritual life. Really, it was quite remarkable. And I know that Basic Youth Conflicts had a lot to do with that. And I know a lot of you that were there during that time went to Basic Youth. But it was always a joy to see the elevation in my dad's spiritual life. But it was enjoyable to see the congregation. You know, we can talk about how Dad provided for our family and things like that. But you, as a congregation and as people, you know that God has provided for you. And it came through him. God placed the word in his mouth and transferred it to you. And because it did, it changed your lives. I know that it did because I've seen it. I've not only seen it in yours, I've seen it in your children's, I've seen it in your grandchildren and your great-grandchildren. You know, that's a blessing to me. Because it's not always just about us. Because he was doing that. Because for you. Not just for you, but the call that God placed on his heart to preach the word of God. And that's what's, you know, I see families and things together. Some of you I don't know because I've been gone for 45 years. His dad will say, do you remember, you know, so-and-so did this? And Dad, I don't know him. Yeah, I've been gone for a long time, you know. But I know that the impact that he's had, not just in this congregation, but in Coweta and Scheidler and Cashin and Union Home, you know, there's been ministers and missionaries and not just in the Christianity field, but for you to be able to go to your job site and you to work and to be able to share God's love and people know that you're a Christian where you're at, you know. And because not all of us can be missionaries. If we all were, there wouldn't be anybody to preach to. So we have to be missionaries of where we're at, whether we're bucking a bale or whether we're moving a barrel or lifting or we're working in an office somewhere. And so that's what I'm so thankful for. And I tell people quite often, you know, the things that you know, they say, oh, Gary, you know, you're such a good son or something. I tell them everything you see good in me came from my mom and dad. All the rest is all my fault. Okay? So I still say that to this day. You know, the things that mom and dad taught me in those short years at each church of making sure that the church was presentable and clean and taken care of and that it would draw and not hinder anybody from coming to hear God's word proclaimed. And I'm so thankful for you all to be here today and to celebrate, you know, this, you know, we're on the other end of the stick, you know. For so many years, I would go with Dad calling on people and seeing him minister. And I remember at Coweta when we had all of the boys of the Vietnam War and we had more young men killed from that small town than any town that size or anywhere in the United States. And Dad, in the late 60s, had to preach several of those messages. And the television stations came down from Tulsa to video that. And that was, you know, there's a lot of different things that I got to experience at Grant, and some of the rest of them possibly did, and Deanne did a little bit. And so just seeing how things went, it's just so good for me to see the growth in you and the maturity of you've stayed with God these many years. And and that it's passed on to your children. So thank you all for coming today. It's so good to see you, and I just thank you for being receptive to God's word. And didn't matter how Dad preached it, whether it was funny or whether it was serious, it was still the word of God is always penetrating, and it will reach the deepest, darkest parts of your heart if you let it. But thank you.
God will make all things new that day. Gone is the curse from which I stumbled and fell. Evil is banished to eternal hell. No more night, no more pain, no more tears, never crying.